Father, we thank you very much for bringing us to the concluding study in the epistle of Paul to the Thessalonians. Thank you for the revelations you have given us from the beginning of the study. We are praying, Lord, that as we come to the conclusion, you do what still needs to be done in every one of our hearts in Jesus' name. And we pray that you raise up people that will go to various localities and communities in this country and countries in Africa and beyond, that will have the same faithfulness of Paul, of Silas, of Timothy, and have the same attendant fruit to their ministry, so that the church we minister to will be strong in Jesus' name. Thank you, Lord, for the answer. In Jesus' name we pray. We come to the end of our study. We're now in chapter 5 of 1 Thessalonians. In this chapter 5, it's like we bring everything to a conclusion. And there are three things we are going to see. Number one, eschatology, the study of the last things. Number two, encouragement, comforting the hearts of the brethren, assuring them that although the terrible day of the Lord was coming, the Lord has not appointed his people unto wrath. Three, exhortation, imperatives, commandments of the word, that now that we know what is coming ahead, the study of the last times, what kind of men and women ought we to be? Eschatology, encouragement, exhortation. I'm dividing the study into three parts. Number one, spiritual enlightenment on the expected return of the Savior. Spiritual enlightenment on the expected return of the Savior. Number two, spiritual edification and exhortation to the saints. Spiritual edification and exhortation to the saints. And then number three, separation from evil and entire sanctification. Separation from evil and entire sanctification. We look at number one, which is spiritual enlightenment and on the expected return of the Savior. We're looking at 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, verse 1. But of the times and the seasons, brethren, ye have no need that I write unto you. You understand the opening word, but. That gives you a connection with the previous chapter. It also gives you a contrast with or to the previous chapter. When you find such a word, you should know what went before and then what comes after. In the previous part, that is the latter part of chapter 4, it's been talking about the rapture. That is Christ coming as the bridegroom and taking the bride, the church, away from the earth. But now he's still talking about eschatology, about event of the last days, but another aspect of such an event. That's why it says, but of the times and the seasons. Brethren, referring to those who have been born again, brothers and sisters in Christ. He said, you do not have any need that I write unto you. Those words, the times and the season. What does that mean? The time of visitation again. The time when the program for the Gentiles will be concluded and God will turn to the Israelites. The time when Christ will come again to establish his kingdom. That's why they were asking the question in Acts of the Apostles, chapter 1, reading from verse 6. When they therefore were come together, they asked of him, saying, Lord, wilt thou at this time restore again the kingdom to Israel? You see the question? The kingdom had departed from Israel. God had rejected the children of Israel. And the light has come to the Gentiles. And now Jesus died, he was buried, he rose again. And on the day he was to ascend, they were asking him, Are you going to now reestablish the kingdom for Israel? Then in verse 7 he said unto them, it is not for you to know the times or the seasons which the Father has put in his own power. So as you look at 1 Thessalonians chapter 5 verse 1, and it says of the times and of the seasons, church, you do not have any need that I write unto you in verse 2, for ye yourselves know perfectly that the day of the Lord cometh as a thief in the night. It says the day of the Lord is coming, and it will come as a thief in the night. Now when you have the mention of the day of the Lord, that day of the Lord is not a 24-hour day. It's not the kind of day you are talking about. It's a special day. And let's run through the word of God. It was a familiar concept to the children of Israel when they had the day of the Lord in Isaiah chapter 13. Isaiah chapter 13, notice all these verses. We don't have time to comment too much on them. In verse 6, how will ye? For the day of the Lord is at hand. You know, when he talked about the rapture, he said, comfort ye one another with these words. When he's talking about the day of the Lord, he didn't say rejoice. He didn't say comfort one another, which means it's a contrast, which means it is not exactly like the rapture. It is a coming day of wrath and terror and judgment and the indignation of God upon the unbelieving. It says, how are ye? Which means scream and cry, for the day of the Lord is at hand. It shall come as destruction from the Almighty, the sinner's doomsday. And then in verse 7, therefore shall all hands faint, and every man's heart shall melt, and they shall be afraid, pangs and sorrows shall take hold of them. They shall be in pain as a woman that travaileth. Notice that when that day comes, the day of the Lord, they will howl, they will scream, they will cry, they will be in pain. It will be like the labor pain of a woman wanting to deliver. They shall be amazed one at another. Their faces shall be as flames. Behold, the day of the Lord cometh, cruel both with wrath and fierce anger, to lay the land desolate, and he shall destroy the sinners thereof out of it. Come back to 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, looking at it from verse 2, for yourselves know perfectly that the day of the Lord so cometh as a thief in the night. When will that day come? Upon whom will the day come? Verse 3, for when they shall say, peace and safety, then sudden destruction cometh upon them. Look at the phrase we saw in Isaiah, as travail upon a woman with child, and they shall not escape. That means then, the day of the Lord is talking about here is after the church is gone. And it's a day of wrath, and it's a day of doom, it's a day of indignation. Other prophets in the Old Testament spoke about it. Joel in particular, in Joel chapter 2, Joel chapter 2, reading from verses 30 and 31, it tells us in verse 30, and I will show wonders in the heavens and in the earth, blood and fire and pillars of smoke. The sun shall be turned into darkness and the moon into blood before the great and terrible day of the Lord come. It's not the comforting day of the Lord. The rapture is for the comfort of the church. But after the rapture of the church will go up and be with the Lord. Then it will be a day of visitation, a period of anguish, a period of wrath, a period of the great tribulation upon the people of the world. That's if you look at 2 Peter, reading there from verse chapter 3, verse 10. 2 Peter chapter 3, verse 10, talking about the day of the Lord, telling us it's different from the time of the rapture. 2 Peter 3, 10. But the day of the Lord will come as a thief in the night, in the which that day the heavens shall pass away with a great noise, and the elements shall melt with fervent heat, and the earth also, and the works that are therein shall be burnt up. And so as we come to this eschatological study, it's telling us it was enlightening the Thessalonians, telling them the day of the Lord is coming, a day of judgment, a day of catastrophe, a day of the wrath of God, when God will visit his wrath upon his enemies. It's called in other parts of scripture the day of doom, in another place the day of vengeance, in the New Testament a day of wrath, in the New Testament still a day of visitation, in the New Testament still the great day of God Almighty. And then he wants to encourage the believers now. He wanted to tell the believers, although that terrible day will be coming, the believers have nothing to be afraid of. If we're children of God, we're not looking for that terrible day, that fearful day of the Lord of judgment and wrath. We're looking for the bridegroom to come from the sky. And then the dead in Christ shall rise forth, and we which are alive shall be caught up together with them to be with him in the clouds, and so shall we ever be with the Lord. And in 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, reading from verse 4, it says, but you brethren are not in darkness, that that day should take you, overtake you as a thief. You are all the children of light and children of the day. We are not of the night nor of darkness. He was enlightening them. He said, you believers, because you belong to Christ and because you are part of the bride of the Lamb, there is nothing to be afraid of. You are not looking for judgment. You are not looking for the visitation of an angry God. But then, after the enlightenment, he now brings encouragement. He says, therefore, in verse 6, let us not sleep as do others, but let us watch and be sober. It says, because we're looking for the coming of the Lord, our gathering together unto him. And he that has this hope purifieth himself even as he is pure. That if you're looking for such things, be diligent that you'll be found of him without blame and spotless, because Christ is coming for a glorious church, a church that has no spot, a church that has no wrinkle. And because you know it can be at any time, in my Father's house are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you, I go to prepare a place for you. And the people that will get to that prepared place are prepared people. And when I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again, and I will receive you unto myself. Some people say that the church will be here forever. I'll receive you unto myself. Where is he? It's at the right hand of majesty, so that where I am, there you will be also. And if you want that relationship, that interaction, that fellowship with Christ up above and for all eternity, let us not sleep, but be awake and watch and be sober. In verse 7 it says, for they that sleep, when do they sleep in the night. And they that be drunken are drunken in the night. Let us who are of the light be sober, putting on the breastplate of faith and love, and for an helmet the hope of salvation. You come across the triads again. He talked about it before in chapter 1. Remembering always your work of faith, your labor of love, and your patience of hope. And even though they add those three essential things, he still was telling them, he still was encouraging them, don't let it go and don't abandon it. It's there now. Let it increase, let it abide, let it become stronger. That's why it says in verse 8, let us, those of us who are of the day, those of us who are of the light, let's be sober, put on the breastplate of faith. Faith must always be there. It's a faith that works, the faith that produces good fruit, and love. Let the labor of love continue, and also as an helmet, the hope of salvation. In verse 9, for God has not appointed us to wrath. The day of the Lord is connected with doom, with wrath, with judgment. It's the time of the great tribulation and onwards. But then it says, the Lord has not appointed us unto wrath. As God removed Noah from that place and put him safe in the ark before the flood came. He'll take the church away before the great tribulation. As Lot and the family were taken away from Sodom before the fire descended, the church will be taken to be with Christ before the wrath of the great tribulation will come. As Rahab and the family and the dependents were taken away from Jericho before they set fire on the whole of Jericho, so the church will get out of this place before the tribulation will come, because God has not appointed us to wrath, but to obtain salvation by our Lord Jesus Christ, who died for us, that whether we wake or sleep, we should live together with him. Wherefore, comfort yourselves. You know, when it comes to the church and it's talking about eschatology, that is the study of the last thing, is for the comfort of the children of God. It says the day of the Lord is coming, the day of doom is coming, the day of wrath is coming, the great terrible day of the Lord is coming. It's a fearful thing for the unbelievers, it's a fearful thing for the careless Christians, the backsliding ones. For the ones who are still standing, you comfort yourselves together and edify one another, even as also ye do. I go to point number two: spiritual edification and exhortation to the saints. As a result of the enlightenment, knowing that the day of the Lord is coming, so that that day will not come upon them unawares, and so that they'll be able to escape the judgment and the wrath that will come upon the world, he now wants to give them edification and exhortation. That's the method of Jesus. When he spoke about that coming time, the coming judgment, immediately he told his disciples how to get prepared so that they will not be caught unawares. Luke chapter 21. Luke chapter 21. Reading from verse 34, take heed to yourselves, lest at any time your hearts be overcharged with surfeiting and drunkenness and the cares of this life, so that they come upon you unawares. He had already told them in another part of the Gospels, Matthew and Luke, that as it was in the day of Noah, in the time of Noah, so shall it be at the coming of the Son of Man. And as it was at the time of Lot, when they were taken away from Sodom and Gomorrah before it was set on fire, so shall it be at the time of the coming of the Lord. But if you are going to escape, it is not without some preparation. That's why he said, you take heed to yourself, you take heed to your life, you take heed to your thoughts, you take heed to your attitude, you take heed to the doctrines you have learned, you take heed to your commitment in the Lord and for the Lord. Then he says, so that your hearts will not be overcharged, overstuffed with surfeiting and drunkenness and the feast and the things of this world and the cares of life. Because the people in the world, they will not know when that thing will come. It will be when they are saying peace and safety, sudden destruction will come upon them. And then in verse 35, for as a snare shall it come on all them that dwell on the face of the whole earth. The coming tribulation is not only for the Jews. The coming tribulation will cover the whole earth, and it will come upon them as a snare. Verse 36, watch ye therefore. He wanted them to escape. He wanted them to be free. He wanted them to have the comfort and the reward of the saints. Watch ye therefore and pray always that ye may be accounted worthy to escape. That tells us again, we're to escape the tribulation, the great tribulation. And I pray that God will count every one of us worthy, that when the trumpet shall sound, and the dead in Christ shall rise, and we which are alive and remain until his coming, and they'll be taken up, you'll be part of them in Jesus' name. That will be counted worthy to escape all these things that shall come to pass, that is, that shall come upon the world, and then you'll be able to stand before the Son of Man. So, now that he told them the great day, terrible day of the Lord was coming, he now was going to give them exhortation. And the exhortation was on different areas. You know, he was talking to the church, and he called them the brethren. And as you look at an individual believer, you have interaction, connection, relationship, fellowship, whatever, with three different kinds of people. Number one, the pastor. Number two, the church. Number three, the outside world. That's what he wants to talk about now. Look at it in chapter 5, reading from verse 12. And we beseech you, brethren, to know them that labor among you and are over you in the Lord, and admonish you, and to esteem them very highly in love for their work's sake, and be at peace among yourselves. Here he told the believers, he said, on the basis that the Lord is coming, because the Lord is coming, and is coming for his own, and he wants to take us away before the day of doom will come upon the world. Number one, have a good relationship with the people that are sacrificing everything so that they can bring the word of life, the word of salvation, and they are preparing you, perfecting you for the coming of the Lord. Know them. The word know there in the original is not just referring to facial recognition. You see him, you say, that's brother so and so. You see how, you say, that's sister so and so. It goes beyond that kind of face recognition. It's talking about knowing them, recognizing them, respecting them, appreciating them enough to appreciate the work, the value, the ministry, the service they render. That's one thing he said, know them. But then it's not only to know them, you know the work they are doing. And then he gives us three words or three things that comprise the work they are doing: the labor, the work to the point of exhaustion, the work to the point of exhaustion. That is the pastors, the leaders, they are working and they are laboring. We have to study, we have to pray, we have to visit, we have to minister to the needs of the people, we have to get sinners into the kingdom, we have to disciple the believers, we have to strengthen the weak, we have a lot of things to do. Number two, we oversee. He said, they are over you in the Lord. Number three, we admonish, we instruct in the truth of God's word. And then he tells us in verse 13, he says, you are going to do something. It says, if you don't do this, your Christian life, your Christian profession is not adequate, it's not complete. Esteem them. I think that would even have been enough. And there are some Christians that will have a hard time even getting to that point. Esteem the leader, the spiritual leader. Esteem the one that is laboring on doctrine, on the word of God. But it doesn't just say esteem them, it said esteem them highly. And it takes people years to come to that, to understand that the one that is teaching the word of God, the one that is showing us the way to heaven, the one that is showing us how to be free from sin, how to be sheltered or shielded from the devil, how to live a holy life, a righteous life, preparing us for the kingdom of God, is the greatest work any man can do, and is the greatest impute anybody can have in your life. Think of all people on earth that you benefit from at school, in the college, at the university, the doctor in the hospital, and the tailor that sews your clothes, and the people that do this or that, the people that do anything for your life, think about them. All they do will benefit you for this time. But the one that commits his life to teaching the word, preaching the word, explaining the word, interpreting the word, is the one that does a lasting work, a work of eternal value on you. That's why it says, number one, esteem them. Number two, esteem them highly. And Paul, that isn't that enough? He said, it's not enough. He said, if you know the depth of the work they do, the height of the work they do, and the lasting effect of what they do, and the eternality, if there's any word like that, the eternal nature of the work they do, you esteem them very highly.
What a lesson for us, that we who are taught will esteem very highly the people that are teaching us in the word of the Lord. But now, Paul the Apostle wants to pass on to another area that the believers needed. And he tells us, look at that verse 13. And be at peace among yourselves. He now comes to the church. He said, we dealt with your relationship with the leader. Now we're dealing with the relationship with the laity. One another, because we're brethren, because we're pilgrims, and because we're going the same direction, and we want to get to heaven, there will be peace among yourselves. And now in verse 14, now we exhort your brethren, warn them that are unruly, and comfort the feeble-minded, support the weak, be patient towards all men. It says it's not just the pastor, it's not just the leader that will want the people that are unruly. We are our brother's keepers. We are our sister's keepers. You look at other people and you see that if they continue like this, they may not make it eventually to heaven. Therefore, you are warning them, you are exhorting them, you are comforting them, you are counseling them, you are encouraging them to move on, you are supporting them with the word of God. It's dealt with the pastor, your relationship with him. It's dealt with the people in the church, your relationship with them. Now he deals with the people outside. Be patient towards all men. Be at peace with all men. Be patient to all men. The people in your office, the people in your community, the people anywhere and everywhere you see them, you have a duty that you will live in the wisdom of God and you will shine the light, that the people in the world that do not know Christ, they will know Christ through your life. And then from verse 15, see that none render evil for evil to any man. It's not talking about the outside people. They'll do evil to you. They'll persecute you. And you will suffer because of what they do. And then it says, you will not render evil for evil unto any man, but ever follow that which is good among yourselves in the church, again, that which is good every time. And then it says, toward all men. Then it says, rejoice evermore. Rejoice always. Again, I say unto you, rejoice, because the joy of the Lord is your strength. And then it says, pray without ceasing. He himself has laid the example. I told you the other time about the frequency of his prayer, the fervency of his prayer, the focus of his prayer. And what he was doing, he said, this is not only for the minister. This is not only for the apostle. We too, as members of the body of Christ, you will concentrate so much on prayer. Pray without ceasing. Then in verse 18, in everything, give thanks. For this is the will of God in Christ Jesus concerning you. He said, in everything, give thanks. Somebody told this little thing. It was a bad day. And because it was a bad day, he was, going around and feeling sorry for himself, as if the whole world was going to collapse. And a brother met him and said, praise the Lord. Oh, he said, I don't know whether I can praise the Lord for a day like this. And then the brother replied, praise the Lord, because every day is not like this. Praise the Lord, because it's only happening like that today. It didn't happen like that yesterday. And it's not going to happen like that every day and forever. Therefore, praise the Lord anyhow, because every day is not like that. In whatever situation you find yourself, you can always look at the brighter side. There's always something to look at that will make you praise the Lord. And then it says, quench not the spirit. Quench not the spirit. The subject of the Holy Spirit is very important to the New Testament believer. In fact, the New Testament has this to say, that if we are children of God, number one, quench not the spirit. Number two, grieve not the Holy Spirit. Ephesians 4:30. Number three, walk in the spirit. Make sure that as we are walking, you are listening to the voice of the Spirit, and you are walking according to the dictates and according to the leading of the Spirit. Number four, you will
Live in the Spirit, Galatians 5, verse 25. And then number 6, you are led by the Spirit. As many as are led by the Spirit, they are the children of God. Ephesians chapter 5, verse 18. Be filled, be controlled, saturated by the Spirit. Number 8, be strengthened by the Spirit. And so he says, we must make sure that we do not grieve the Spirit of God. We must make sure that we do not quench the Spirit of God. Let the Spirit of God overflow in you. And as you are walking, as you are living, let him be in control every time. Then he says, despise not prophesying. That is, despise not the words that come from God coming through a human vessel. And the greatest prophecy is what you hold in your hand. We have a more sure word of prophecy, which will be good if you take heed unto. Because the prophets of old, they didn't speak out of their own mind, but holy men of God spoke as they were moved by the Holy Ghost. Therefore, you will not despise the word of God. The written word of God is the authoritative message from God. And we must never despise, we must never treat lightly, we must never belittle the word of God. And then he says, prove all things and hold fast to that which is good. Which means, as you are hearing the word, you will be looking at the word and comparing the word with the scriptures. And as you compare with the scriptures, you will see what is good. And when you hear that word, you must be able to differentiate between wheat and chaff. And then you push off the chaff and you take the wheat, the thing that can build your Christian life in a solid way. You prove all things. Somebody comes with a dream, prove all things. They come with a vision, prove all things. They come with whatever it is. They told me this, they told me this. They come with something very, very interesting. It may look interesting, but you prove it. If, you know, little children, that's the problem their parents have with them. Because the solid food that will be able to build them up, they may not want to take because it's not sweet enough in their mouth. But when you take chaff, there are some people, they take chaff and they grind it very well. And they put some onion, and they put some salt, and they put some honey, and they put some oil to you, and they fry it. And when little children taste that, not knowing that it is chaff that is well baked, they just take that. Then you call them to come and take balanced diet of the word of God. They say, Mommy, I'm not hungry. They say, Mommy, I don't feel like. They say, Mommy, it's not sweet. I have another thing. And they go for their fried chaff to take that again. But we who are maturing and we who are growing in the Lord and in the word, you will prove all things. And then when you know that this is solid food, this is balanced diet, this is a word that will make a man to grow in the Lord and grow until we see the Lord, you will hold on to that which is good. Number 3, separation from evil and entire sanctification. Separation from evil and entire sanctification. Look at verse 22. Abstain from all appearance of evil. When you look at that, you understand the concept the writers of the New Testament had on living a righteous life. What concept? You can see it very clearly. I look at that verse, I divide it into 3 parts. 1, abstain from evil. If you hear that, there's no way you can go into any evil. If you were to keep that, just simply abstain from evil, that would have been sufficient. But then Paul the Apostle said, abstain from all evil. And then he even says, after you have avoided evil, avoided all forms of evil, abstain from all appearance of evil. It's not even enough that I say I'm keeping myself away from evil. The conversation, doesn't it have an appearance of evil? The interaction, doesn't it have an appearance of evil? The deal in your place of work, doesn't it have an appearance of evil? It's telling you, abstain. refrain, get away, avoid every form, all appearance of evil. And actually, as you look at the Bible, you will see that the devil, which is one letter short of the devil, you will see that if you are going to be free from danger and evil from the devil, you are going to run away from evil at all costs. We're told in Psalm 37 verse 27, depart from evil. We're told in Psalm 119 verse 101, refrain from every evil way. We're told from Isaiah chapter 56 and in verse 2, it says, keep your hand from doing any evil. And then we're told in Titus chapter 3 verse 2, speak evil of no man. In 2 Corinthians chapter 13 verse 7, it says, do no evil, but that which is honest. In Isaiah chapter 33 verse 15, it says, shut your eyes from seeing evil. And then it tells us, 1 Peter chapter 3 verse 10, refrain your tongue from evil. Zechariah chapter 8 verse 17, it says, not to imagine evil in your heart against your neighbor. And then 1 Corinthians 13, 5, think no evil. You don't even think it. You don't do it. You don't participate in it. Your hands will not be there. You will not go. You will not walk to any place of evil. Your eyes will not even see what is evil. Abstain from all appearance of evil. And then he tells us in verse 23, and the very God of peace sanctify you wholly. And I pray your whole body, your whole spirit and soul and body be preserved blameless unto the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ. We've been talking about that. That's the second work of grace. That's the operation of God when God comes and he circumcises our hearts. And he cleanses us and purges us within. And the different languages or terms are used in the Bible. In Deuteronomy chapter 30. Verse 6, and the Lord thy God will circumcise thine heart and the heart of thy seed to love the Lord thy God with all thine heart and with all thy soul that thou mayest live. When the Lord actually does it, if a man purge himself from all these, he'll be a vessel unto honor, sanctified, meet, fit, suitable for the master's use. That's what the Lord wants to do. If he has done it already, please keep the experience. If he's still to do it, trust the Lord, he will do it. In Ezekiel chapter 36, verse 25, then will I sprinkle clean water upon you, and ye shall be clean, and from all your filthiness and all your idols will I cleanse you. That's salvation. You come to the Lord, and you come filthy, defiled, and dirty. And then you come under the fountain of the blood of the Lamb. And it comes upon you. And the touch of that blood of the Lamb cleanses you from all your outward sins. Salvation. Verse 26, sanctification. A new heart also will I give you. And a new spirit will I put within you. And I will take away. Take away. Take away. When it's taken away, it's no more there. I'll take away the stony heart out of your flesh. I will give you an heart of flesh. That's sanctification. Verse 27. And I will put my spirit within you and cause you to walk in my statutes, and you shall keep my judgments and do them. That's the Holy Ghost baptism. Salvation, sanctification, and the spirit baptism. Please come to 1 Thessalonians chapter 5. Verse 24, faithful is he that calleth you, who also will do what? He will do it. Can he do it in our lives? You have heard about the coming of the Lord. You have heard that the Lord is coming, and surely is coming. We spoke about that much yesterday. And the Lord is wanting us to prepare ourselves. And I pray that as we are together here, and it's been a wonderful time here, isn't it wonderful? And a few people have been able to interact with, members of Deeper Life, and even those that we invited as delegates from outside Deeper Life, Some of them are telling me, actually all, I just want to be moderate, they are telling me that they've never seen anything like this. They enjoy it, and they are telling me, asking me questions from various countries and various ministries. Can we send our ministers here to be trained? Can we send our workers here to be trained? I said, we're at your service. We're willing to do anything, and we're going to do whatever we can do. And here we are. We've brought everything and placed it in your hand. It's now in your hand. You'll take it everywhere you go. And the same thing we're preaching here, you too, you will preach where you go in Jesus' name. You will stand on the same word, and the Lord will stand by you. And the same power, the same anointing, the same success, everything he has given us here, he will give unto you in Jesus' name. One of the people that came outside our ministry said they have been challenged with a place like this. He told me that the conference center, largest in their country, can only take 300 people. When he came in here and he saw all of you good people here, how you are taking in the word of God, he said God gave him a vision that he will have a conference center that will take at least 3,000 to 5,000. And he wants me to tell all of you so that you'll pray for him. We're going to pray for them. That all of us who are here, as God has prospered us, God will prosper them. And the work is prospering here. The work will prosper in your hand. Let's rise up. The Lord is wanting to bless us and use us as channels of blessing for other people. He will use you. He will use you. You're a vessel of honor in the hand of the Lord. Open your mouth now and talk to the Lord in prayer.